journey, it started in this area with, I was a main caregiver for my mother who had Alzheimer's. And she died in 2011. And about three, I had, during the time, the last few years, I had been noticing with myself that I was having some very unusual visual issues. Things that sometimes people get once or twice, but they were consistent with me. Very bad glare to the point that in the dark I stopped writing. Double the cup of the moon and see two of them. And when I try to read, I get things coming out, numbers and things and letters coming out, popping out. And I kept going. I'm a person that I was never in the hospital except when I had with my children. I had never taken pills, never been sick. And I went going for my annual checkup, and I'd always sort of say something, you know, is this, and I'd get sort of, well, you know, it's probably stress. So go and get your eyes tested. And so I went to eye doctors and they test my eyes. Your eyes are just fine. Must be stress. This went on for 3 years. That's very typical for PCA. And then 1 year, I guess my GP decided that maybe she would look for a person, neurologist, to give me some tests. Not that she would believe it was anything. But that took about 6 months, of course. Long time. And we did do the tests, the tests and all those, and of course they didn't show anything because they were not primarily visual testing. They didn't go very much, but they did say, okay, well, you could go over to Vancouver, there's a specialist there, maybe you should go and see. So I did go, and I spent a day with my husband over there, half a day anyway, going through all these tests. And at the end of the day, he opened the door, he came in and chatted with his little friend with his back to me, and then turned around and said, well, you have early onset Alzheimer's. And I just, was just like a block on the head, like, what? And she, and then he followed that with, you know, of course, that's it, it's the table. There's nothing I can do, but here's a prescription for Aricept, a pill, and I'll see you in 6 months. And he turned to my husband and said, she just got to learn to live with it. So we got into the, we've gone to Vancouver, we got right into the bubble, go back home, and I just dropped to the floor. At this point, I just want to sort of, I knew I was just completely wiped out. I wasn't, the one thing I knew was that I was not going to take that. I would never take a pill. I didn't know anything about it. I had no knowledge about what PCA was at that point. I knew in my heart, though, that I didn't have Alzheimer's. So I'm just going to just take a little bit of a turn here and say that what came on to me was born really by the work that I had done throughout my course in my work in government. I was did a lot of work in strategic planning and future planning, and in that time I had come to understand in a very healthy way that all that kind of planning and that is gone, those long plans. There's much too much uncertainty in the world and in our life to be having long plans. And there's a new kind of planning. And what was involved was, I guess the quote that was most profound for me was the person who said, well, here we are, and all our facts and all that we know is yesterday's. And everything that we have to decide is the future. So how the heck are we going to deal with the future? And what happens is that one of the things that I did a lot of with the company, and it really works, and went to a lot of places like this, and is the use of a scenario. So I'm going to use those terms because they just was what came to me. As I came home and sat there, that was what I saw. I saw a person sitting here who all of a sudden has just lost all the certainty in their life. I don't have a life anymore. I don't know who I am. I don't know what. I don't know anything about this. I'm not an expert here. You know, what am I supposed to do? How do I make any decisions at this point? Because sometimes the people in the Alzheimer's, they're pressing you to make a lot of, you know, decisions. I think that's crazy. I was just out of my mind. I didn't have let anyone know, like other people have said here. I knew that the only thing I could do is it wasn't a good thing to act, because I didn't know anything. But it was a good thing to do a lot of research. It's the time to research when you don't know. So I sat for a month in front of my computer and did research. I didn't tell my kids, and my son just went into my computer and looked at the history and figured out what was up. So, there were three things that came out, three wonderful things. The first was, I found in there the Benson, the person who first in the 80s put out PCA, which I at that point hadn't heard of, but had a nice list of symptoms. And I just looked at them and my jaws dropped. I went all the way down. They were right. They were there. And he himself was very, very to accept that it was Alzheimer's because it's so different. But anyway, so that was really good. That made it feel very strong for me that that was right. So I went back to my GP and told her, and she knows very well, put me up with someone else who was able to do much better testing. Very, very specific about my eye and control and the visual. And it was just so obvious and things to her about that, that I couldn't do. And she agreed that I had PCA, so at that point, when I did go back to see the other doctor, he refused to accept it, calls it something else, which is fine with me. So that was one of the things. The next thing was discovering the work of Terry Pritchett, who is, for anybody who is science fiction fantasy fan, knows is one of the most famous in the world. And he too has PCA, and he's done an incredible job of writing about PCA in a way that made me really understand what it was about. But the third thing was the most important, and that was the discovery of the London group it's a group of people who were coming together at that time. They were all people who had family or some relationship with PCA. It was totally unique. There was no other group doing that. And they were very, very keen. They were very, very good people. A lot of them had husbands, for instance, who was major surgeons, or they were nurses in British hospitals, or and they opened a they had a closed Facebook startup, and I joined that, and I wasn't somebody at that point that was using social media, but I changed my mind. It saved my life, basically. What they have done is absolutely wonderful. And we share, I am in there every day, what I call mini scenarios, which is basically sharing your stories. And for me, this book, every day, there's people sharing their stories. And what for me I can do is that I can see into the future what some things might be, what some symptoms might be. And I can, And what I will do is ask myself, if that would happen to me, what could I do now? What can I do now to that would help me then? And that's very much what I do and how I play it now. I don't, and I think it's really important that we as people, as patients, share our stories, because there's incredible knowledge in them, and it's the way we're going to learn from each other how we get through and how we can make things and how we can